economic modelling was used to justify a ridiculous jobs claim when the economist they hired then had to say, oh, it's not true.
And the reason that the court cases are so important is because lying to journalists can be funny and lying to a judge is a crime.
G'day and welcome to Follow the Money, the Australia Institute's podcast demystifying the big economic issues in Australia and putting them in plain English. I'm Ebony Bennett, Deputy Director at the Australia Institute, and in episode 9 of Follow the Money, we unpack economic modelling with our Chief Economist Richard Dennis and Director of Research Rod Campbell. Economic modelling sounds like an extensive, rigorous, scientific exercise. But is it really?
One for mum, one for dad, one for the country.
And there has never been a more exciting time to be in Australia.
Dead, buried, cremated.
Australia's basically done for. We'll just end up being a third-rate economy. You know, a banana republic.
Just follow the money.
But leading the news, a new economic report has found Bill Shorten's proposed changes to negative gearing would have a disastrous impact on the economy.
BIS shrapnel claims Mr. Shorten's plans would force down house values, push up rents by 10% and throw thousands of people out of work.
Early this year, just before the federal election, economic forecaster BIS Shrapnel ran its economic models over Labor's proposed changes to the negative gearing tax benefits. The economic model found that negative gearing reforms would push down house prices and drive up rents, essentially bad news for Labor's fledgling policy. The report made front page news, and the Treasurer, Scott Morrison, pounced.
What the BIS Shrapnel report says today is it's bad news if you own a home, it's bad news if you're an investor in a home, and it's bad news if you're renting a home. That's three strikes and you're out on Labor's policy.
But the numbers and assumptions behind BIS Shrapnel's economic model didn't quite stack up. And within 24 hours, the report was largely considered bunk. BIS Shrapnel refused to say who commissioned the modelling, and it later emerged the report had been prepared before Labor's policy was even announced.
This document from BIS Shrapnel is riddled with errors. I say to you very carefully that if a first-year accountancy student lodged this document for an exam, they would be failed and kicked out.
I referred to that as peak stupid. Let's hope that's the low point, not just of economic modelling in Australian public debate, but politicians' reliance on that economic modelling. We had a treasurer out there waving around a report that it's doubtful anyone in his office had even read.
Yeah.
And that's kind of the point. No one really cares what's in a model. They care what the press release about the model said.
Can we get back to calling it the BS shrapnel?
So how do economic models work? What exactly are the questions or assumptions that economists base their models on? Are there guidelines for economists, or do they just make it up? And will the public ever find out?
Economic modelling is the perfection of econobabble. It's econobabble in its finest form.
In its most purest. Distilled.
It's the essence of econobabble. No one has any idea what it means when confronted with Treasury modelling showing that the growth dividend of a corporate tax cut is 0.1% of GDP.
Yeah.
It's designed to be inaccessible. It is a black box that only a handful of Australians are allowed to look inside, yet all Australians are the victims or beneficiaries of what the models say we can or can't afford.
And Rod, is an understanding of economic modelling something that all economics graduates come out with at the other end of their degrees?
No, it's not. In fact, in my economics degree, I can't remember doing a subject on modelling. So I distinctly remember the first time somebody brought me a model showing that a particular coal mine was going to generate thousands and thousands of jobs, even though it was only going to employ a couple of hundred people. And I remember thinking, gee, this looks pretty complicated. I've got an economics degree and I don't even know how it's working.
So it's a language not even economists speak generally.
No, and language that the few economists that do speak it don't necessarily share with other economists who claim to speak it. So Rod might not understand my model and I might not understand his. But
neither of you will tell the other what...
Absolutely, that's commercial in confidence, what's buried in my little black box.
What you'll see a lot is the results of a modelling exercise will be in a press release, and when you go looking for the modelling itself, we haven't put that out yet. You call the Minerals Council a few days after the press releases around their annual economic impact of the mining sector modelling exercise is done. A few days after the press release comes out, then they'll put out the full report because they've already got the headline. By the time somebody's taken the time to go through Appendix Z of the report that shows you how silly their assumptions were, we've all moved on.
Yeah.
And that's part of the point.
Absolutely. And the assumptions are very important for people to understand. If you assume that cutting taxes will lead to an increase in investment, then when you build a model with that assumption, when you ask the model what will happen if we cut taxes, you'll find that it will lead to an increase in investment. But there's a big difference between what a model assumes and what a model concludes. But when a politician waves modelling around saying, this model proves that cutting taxes will lead to an increase in investment, that's a meaningless statement if all the model does is assume that cutting taxes will lead to an increase in investment.
What does Adani mean to Queensland? Adani means 10,000 jobs for Queensland workers, from young apprentices.
While economic models may not come under forensic scrutiny by journalists before their conclusions are splashed all over the front pages, it's a lot different in a court of law, where economic modelling may have real-world impacts on people's lives.
Let's name names, shall we, Ebony? Adani's Carmichael mine got through Queensland's planning process claiming that they would create 10,000 jobs because their model assumed that there was an infinite labour force and an infinite amount of water that the farmers around there could use, and, in fact, infinite everything.
Is that realistic, do you think?
If you give me an infinite amount of time to answer that question, Richard. No, it's not a realistic assumption. And so the assumptions that went into that model, suddenly when Adani were in court, they decided to review that model and commission a different one that was based on different assumptions, and suddenly their own economist had to say, I think it'll only be about 1,500 jobs. Economic modelling was used to justify a ridiculous jobs claim that's still used in the Queensland media when the company itself, or the economist they hired, then had to say, it's not true. So, you know, in terms of commission the model, put out the results and worry about the details later, Queensland has heard years of Adani equals 10,000 jobs. Even Adani knows that's not true, but actually they keep saying it. So, you know, you can certainly get bang for your modelling buck on the political front.
And the reason that the court cases are so important is because lying to journalists can be funny and lying to a judge is a crime. So
an important distinction.
It is an important distinction. I mean, another great example was Rio Tinto. Their consultants initially claimed that extending the Warkworth coal mine would create 44,000 jobs in the Hunter Valley. We argued in court that we weren't sure exactly how many jobs would be created, but about zero would be about right. And we won that argument.
There's a massive gap between zero and 44,000.
Well, this was an extension to existing coal mine. And the extension,
so it wasn't even a new one.
Wasn't even a new one. And it was proposed in a mining community at the peak of a mining boom.
The very consultants that decided it could create 45,000 jobs were at the same time in the media screaming, skills shortage, there's not enough people to work in the mines here.
Let's start with Adani Mining, the Carmichael mine. Our government supports this project, which would create over 10,000 jobs. That's 10,000.
Regional Queenslanders, this is a project that promises thousands of jobs in the construction.
And what are the big, I guess, government agencies say about this kind of modelling and how it's used?
thank you. I mean, it's bizarre, but really so little effort has been put in by state government and federal government bureaucracies to examining the claims that are made in these reports.
Well, it depends on your department. If you're the ABS, you're very worried about input-output modelling and you say that it's a biased estimator of a project's value. If you're the Productivity Commission, you're also very worried and you know that this is often abused. Whereas you've got other departments who are actively involved in promoting these methods. The New South Wales Division of Resources and Energy publishes multipliers that it wants project proponents, mainly coal mines, to use. Treasury knows and the ABS knows and the Productivity Commission knows that what Division of Resources and Energy are doing is completely misleading, biased and abusing economics, and yet it's generally up to people like us and the public to point that out.
But what are the social and environmental costs of a big mining development on a community, for example? How much of a dollar value do we put on clean air or clean water? How much is a human life worth? These are the critical questions that are strangely missing from many economic models.
Look, when we try to evaluate the economic benefits of a big project or a big policy change, we have to decide which costs and which benefits to include in our model. So it's common to include gross domestic product, unemployment, exports. There's good data on all of those things and they're typically included. But when we build a new coal mine, for example, we are going to typically disrupt the natural environment. We might destroy a habitat for an endangered species. We might pollute water, which is being used for another source. We might harm the Great Barrier Reef and not just harm the biology of the reef, but the tourism potential of the reef. Sometimes we make policy decisions which usually indirectly lead to people dying, if not immediately, but earlier than they otherwise would. So the economist who's asked to evaluate these projects is actually being asked to put a dollar value on everything from peace and quiet to the value of fresh water to the value of a species to the value of a human life. And to be clear, no economist knows what your human life is worth. We can have a crack. We're very happy to have a crack. But most people think that their life is quite valuable.
Invaluable even.
Some say. So if as a society we want to ask hard questions like, do we want to have cleaner air or more coal mines? That's a really hard question to answer. Economic models help to conceal that question's even being asked.
While other professional groups, such as doctors, lawyers, or even actuaries, are governed by a set of rules or a professional set of ethical guidelines, economists don't have to follow any such thing. The Australia Institute wants to change that, and we're calling for an economic modelling code of conduct that will help make the models clear and transparent to journalists and easily available to the public for scrutiny.
So we're involved in the court case against New Acland Coal on the Darling Downs, where the judge had said to New Hope, I'd really like it if you'd rerun your models at current coal prices, because they were basing their models on prices that are about 100% higher than they are at the moment. The judge has asked for this, and they've said they don't want to because that'd cost about $30,000. They said that the community group can run their own model, modelling their preferred assumptions. That'll cost $140,000.
Whoa.
No, there's no ethics in economics. Actuaries have a code of conduct. They systematically reveal the key assumptions they've made and justify why they've made them. Accountants typically have a professional code of conduct.
And there's all sorts of professions. Professional bodies that you have to be recognised by and accredited by to practice. To be an economist, you just have to put out your sign and say, hi, I'm an economist, models for sale. Would you like to be an economist, Ebony?
Sure.
I now declare you an economist.
Sounds
you
like there's one. Good money in it.
Only if you're prepared to speak nonsense.
I have have no time for any of this modelling on anything. Then we had modelling on the GST. Honestly, whether it's Labor, Liberal or whatever, I don't have any time for this modelling.
That's been episode 9 of Follow the Money, brought to you by the Australia Institute. You can subscribe on iTunes or find previous episodes at tai.org.au/podcasts. Richard Dennis's book Econobabble is available now from redbackquarterly.com.au, or you can find it on Amazon and in all good bookshops. You can follow Richard on Twitter at rdns_tai. You can find Rod's papers on the Australia Institute's website, or follow him at r_o_d_c. You can follow me at Ebony_Bennett with a double N double T. Or the Twitter handle for the Australia Institute is the Oz Institute with an AUS. This episode was produced by Jennifer Macy. Jonathan McFeet from Pulse and Thrum composed our title track. And you can find more of his music at pulseandthrum.com. Thanks for listening.